Hey, good morning, everybody. My name is John Motley, and I'm here to do some worship with you guys before we open up the Word together. Would you guys please take a moment and bow your heads and your hearts and pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this opportunity to sing to you. God, I just pray wherever we are at right now, Lord, that you would just touch our hearts, touch our minds, and help us to sing to you with all of our hearts. May these not just be songs that we sing to you just because some guy is singing them. May this not be something we just watch somebody else do, but may this be something that we engage in, something that we all do together as your people, singing to you, Jesus. So go before us now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You're welcome to sing along even in your homes as you sing along with me. This song's called Your Love Never Fails.
Thank you. Thank you.
Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Love that you have for every single person on this earth, much less those of us who are joining in right now. Father, I pray that you would give us that better understanding of your love and what you've done for us, that amazing grace that you have for us, and that we would understand this amazing grace just a little bit better as we open up your word together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi everyone, my name is Miss Jen and I'm super excited to talk about today's lesson with you. So this weekend is super special to us as Christians. We celebrated Good Friday and we're celebrating Easter Sunday. What do those things mean? And where can we find the accounts of this historical true story in the Bible? Well, we'll talk all about that. So before we begin, just make sure you have a Bible, you have a pen to take notes, and let's begin. So Good Friday, what does that mean? What happened on Good Friday? Jesus was crucified and placed in a tomb, but on the third day, he rose from the dead. He appeared to Mary, his disciples, and other followers to show that he had risen. Jesus' death and resurrection conquered sin and death, so we can have forgiveness of sin and the promise of eternal life with God. So Easter Sunday, what does that mean? What important event do we remember? The resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Easter is such an exciting and important day because we remember how Jesus rose from the grave. We have a risen Savior. We're going to look at the accounts in the Bible that record this true historical event, the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all record Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. Each writer had his own perspective, and some included different details they thought were important depending on who they were writing for. From their four accounts, we get the full picture of what happened. But first, let's review what we learned in our last lesson. So before we begin and we jump into the Bible, let's just pray together. Thank you, Lord, for this day, and thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. Thank you, Lord, that you are our risen King and that we can celebrate that and just put all our hope in you, God. Even when it's difficult, Lord, help us, give us wisdom, grace, and help us to understand your word. Help us to believe, Lord, in these accounts, and that we could trust that you are the true living God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, guys, so in your last lesson, you learned what city did Jesus enter riding on a donkey? Which city in Israel? Starts with a J. You're right, Jerusalem. Jesus came to Jerusalem and was welcomed by the people as the promised Messiah. People threw their cloaks and tree branches on the road for Jesus to ride over. That was how they greeted kings. The people were excited because they'd heard about the amazing miracles Jesus had done, healing people, casting out demons, feeding thousands of people with one lunch, and calming storms. Many Jewish people thought that their Messiah would be a military leader who would defeat the Romans. But is this what Jesus came to do? No. Our sins are a bigger problem than who's leading a country or making the rules here on earth. That's because our sin separates us from a holy, righteous God. God planned to send his son, Jesus, to earth to be the perfect sacrifice. Jesus willingly chose to take our punishment when he died for us on the cross. When he died, the punishment for sin was paid. It seemed like it was the end when Jesus died, but it wasn't. The Roman guards broke the legs of the criminals crucified with Jesus so they would die faster. But when they came to Jesus, he was already dead. The guards pierced his side with a spear to make sure. A wealthy Jewish man from Arimathea named Joseph was a secret follower of Jesus. He went to Pilate, the Roman governor, and asked to have the body of Jesus so he could give him a proper burial. Pilate agreed, and Joseph took the body of Jesus down from the cross. Joseph took his body and wrapped it in linens. Linens were strips of cloth, usually covered with spices to mask the smell of a dead body. Then Joseph laid Jesus in his own tomb in a garden near the place where Jesus was crucified. This tomb was more like a cave carved from stone than graves that we dig into the ground today. The tomb of a wealthy man like Joseph usually had an open doorway and some steps leading into one or more rooms where they laid the bodies. But this was a new tomb. Nobody had been placed in it until Joseph put Jesus in there. Joseph rolled a stone in front of the entrance of the tomb, then went home for the Sabbath. Jesus's mother and some other women went with Joseph to see where he laid Jesus's body so that they could return after the Sabbath to care for the body. But the Jewish leaders who hated Jesus weren't satisfied that he was dead. Let's see what they did. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 27, that's big 27, and find verse 62. So Matthew 27, little 62. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered together to Pilate. So who went to Pilate to discuss the body of Jesus? The chief priests and Pharisees. That's what it says, right? These men were the Jewish religious leaders who had plotted against Jesus. They arrested him, tried him, and handed him over to Pilate to be killed. What were they worried about? So let's read a little bit more. Saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise.'" So the men, what were they worried about? They were worried that the disciples of Jesus would come steal the body and claim that Jesus rose from the dead. So these men remembered that Jesus had said that he would rise on the third day. They didn't believe that would happen, but they didn't want Jesus' disciples taking the body and claiming that he returned to life. What did Pilate suggest they do to keep this from happening? All right, let's read chapter 64. "Therefore, command that the tomb be secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say to the people, 'He has risen from the dead.' So the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard. Go your way, make it as secure as you know." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. Okay, so they remembered what he said, so they were trying to prevent anything that would make it look as if Jesus rose. So they did a couple of things. They didn't believe it would happen, but they didn't want Jesus' disciples taking his body and claiming that he returned to life. What did Pilate suggest they do to keep this from happening? They secured Jesus' tomb with guards, right? They had guards in the front. And that's exactly what they did. They got Roman guards to seal the stone in front of the tomb and stand to watch. They thought there was no way of Jesus coming back. What does that mean to seal something? Have you ever sealed a letter? It has like a little bit of glue, and you usually lick it or you put water on it to seal it, right? To seal it shut. So they had a way of sealing the tomb. So let's read what happened when the women returned to the tomb. Let's turn to Matthew 28 and let's read from verses 1 to 10. So you can take your time. You could press pause and look for that verse. He is risen. Now, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, and as he said, come, see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." So they came the day after the Sabbath, or the first day of the week, which is Sunday. The Sabbath for the Jewish people began Friday evening at sunset and ended Saturday evening at sunset. So they came very early, before dawn on Sunday morning. Which woman came to the tomb to prepare Jesus's body for burial? Yep, we said Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. So on the way to the tomb, the women were wondering how they would roll the stone out of the way since it was so large. But what did the women see when they came to the tomb? The stone had been rolled away by the angel. The angel was sitting on the stone. Why do you think the angel rolled back the stone? Some people think that it was to let Jesus out of the tomb, but Jesus didn't need help to get out of the tomb. In his resurrected body, he could appear and disappear wherever he wanted. We'll read about that in a bit. The angel rolled away the stone so that people could see that he was gone. He was not there anymore. What did the angel look like? What does the Bible say? His appearance was like what? Was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. What did the guards do when the earthquake happened and the angel came down from heaven? They trembled with fear and became like dead men. The angel's appearance freaked these guys out. They either became unconscious or they didn't move because they were paralyzed with fear. The angel also took care of the stone. What did the angel say to the women about Jesus? Look in your Bible. Was he still there? Was he showing them that they were there? No. The angel told them he is not here, for he has risen as he said. So the angel told the women not to be afraid. Jesus was risen. They could look and see the empty tomb. Then they were told to go tell the disciples the good news. How did the women feel in this in verse 8? Let's look at verse 8. They were fearful but joyful. Then what happened in verse 9? Jesus appeared to them and spoke to them. The women fell down and worshiped Jesus. Imagine the joy of these women that they must have felt when they heard that Jesus was alive and saw him. The Gospel of Luke records how the women rushed to tell the disciples and Jesus' followers. The men did not believe when the women told them about the angel and seeing Jesus. But John's gospel records how John and Peter raced to the tomb. They saw the linen cloths that Joseph had wrapped around the body of Jesus, and they saw the cloth from Jesus' head lying folded in place by itself. They knew that couldn't happen by accident. Jesus must be alive. Jesus was risen. Remember the guards who were supposed to stand watch at Jesus' tomb? They eventually recovered, and some of them went to the chief priest and told them what happened. The Jewish leaders didn't want anyone to know that Jesus was alive, so they paid the guards to spread the story that the disciples came and stole the body, that they stole Jesus' body while they were asleep. Does that make sense? Are guards supposed to be asleep while they're on duty? And if they were asleep, how did they know who stole the body? But Jesus wanted his followers to know and see that he was alive. They didn't need to be sad or afraid anymore. So let's read John 20, 19 through 20. John 20, big 20. John 20, 19 through 20. And then we're going to read John 20, 24 through 29. Okay. So then the same day and evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side, where the disciples were. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them. And he said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, "We have seen the Lord." So he said to them, "Unless I see his hands and the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside and Thomas with them. Jesus came, and the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, "Peace to you." And he said to Thomas, "Reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing." And Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Thomas, because you have seen me and you have believed, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So Thomas did believe, right? Let's go to Luke 24, and we're going to read verses 44 through 48. Luke 44, just before John. Luke 24. Luke 24, 44 through 48. All right. Then he said to them, "These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me." And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. Then he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it is necessary for Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things." So his disciples knew who he was. Jesus died on the cross and was placed in a tomb, but he didn't stay there. God raised him from the dead, and Jesus appeared to many of his followers. Jesus' resurrection on the third day, as he promised and as scripture says, conquered death so that we can have forgiveness and eternal life with God when we die. We no longer have to fear death. If we've repented of our sins and trust Jesus as our Savior. Because the resurrection shows that Jesus is God, many people today try to say it's not true. They don't want to be judged for their sins by a holy God. Instead, some say that Jesus didn't really die on the cross. But we know that's silly. We have the descriptions of Jesus' suffering and death at the hands of the Romans. No one survived crucifixion. Others say that the women and disciples who saw Jesus were all having hallucinations, just imagining that they saw Jesus because they missed him so much and were so sad. But we know that's impossible for so many people to have the same hallucination or imagination at different times and different places. 1 Corinthians tells us that over 500 people saw Jesus after he had been crucified and before he returned to heaven. That's a lot of witnesses. It's sad that people try to come up with reasons to deny the truth of the Bible, but we trust God's word. God promised a Savior would come, and he sent Jesus. Like the disciples, we can be changed from frightened followers to bold witnesses. We can share the good news of Jesus with others. So let's pray together, guys. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for what you did on the cross for us and how you suffered, Lord, so that we could be forgiven for our sins. Lord, we lift up our sins to you and ask you, Lord, to please forgive us, Lord, and help us to be more like you, my God. Help us, Lord, to always just be grateful to you, Lord, even when we don't understand, God. And we pray that you would prepare us and embolden us to share your good news, to share your word, Lord, and to just rejoice today for what you've done for us and for being our risen King. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, guys, enjoy the day and God bless you all. Bye.